हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू द ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम प्रोफेसर सरोज मलिक फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस। टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग मॉड्यूल वुमेन्स मूवमेंट्स इन इंडिया, प्री इंडिपेंडेंस मूवमेंट्स, वुमेन पार्टिसिपेशन इन द नेशनल मूवमेंट, पोस्ट इंडिपेंडेंस एंड करंट मूवमेंट्स इन इंडिया, दैट इज तेलंगाना मूवमेंट 1948-50, चिपको मूवमेंट 1973, नवनिर्माण मूवमेंट 1974 एंड द क्वेश्चन ऑफ रिप्रेजेंटेशन इन पॉलिटिक्स फ्रॉम पेपर फेमिनिज्म एंड वुमेन्स मूवमेंट्स। द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द मॉड्यूल इज टू नो द रोल ऑफ वुमेन इन नेशनल मूवमेंट्स एंड वुमेन्स मूवमेंट्स। Women's movements in India, pre-independence movements. Pre-independence period marked by two important landmarks in the history of women's movement. Firstly, the birth of All India Women's Organization, and secondly, the beginnings of women's participation in the national movement. Both processes heralded changes probably unforeseen by founders of women's organization and pioneers who championed the involvement of women in India's freedom struggle. Indian women's movement, if early attempts at reforming the conditions under which Indian women lived were largely conducted by men. By the late 19th century, women themselves joined in movements. By the earlier 20th century, women's own autonomous organization began to be formed and women's activism was constructed. The decade 1910 to 1920 was one in which first attempts at setting up All India Women's Organizations were made. The earliest women's organizations were both urban and sectarian in a non-pejorative sense, for they were Arya Samajist or Brahmo Samaj. From the late 19th to the early 20th century, they were followed by local or regional women's organizations, such as the Bang Mahila Samaj and the Aghore Kamini Nari Samiti in Bengal, Sabha in Maharashtra, Mahila Seva Samaj in Bangalore, the Bharat Mahila Parishad in Banaras, the Paryas Mahila Samiti in Allahabad. Some of these were practical social reform organizations. Others were mere discussion platform for women. The All India Muslim Ladies Conference, Anjuman-e-Khawateen-e-Islam, was founded on March 1, 1914, was part of a ceremony inaugurating a new residence hall for Aligarh Girls School. The Sheikh and Begum Abdullah encountered many obstacles in their effort to establish a girls' school. Women India Association, WIA. The establishment of the Women's India Association in 1917 was the first attempt to organize women on an All India basis. The founding members of the organizations were Annie Besant, Margaret Cousins, and Dorothy Jeeva Rajadhara. They were committed to fight for women's suffrage and India's national freedom. aims and objective of the association. Right to education and compulsory primary education for all boys and girls, abolition of child marriages and other social evils, to secure representation of women in municipalities, talukas, local bodies, legislative council and assemblies, to establish equality of rights and opportunities between men and women. The National Council of Women in India, NCWI, was formed in 1925. It was an elite body and had two aspects. One, international, it being a part of worldwide organization, and other, national, as its actual practical work as all national and local. The organization stressed that Indian women had special talent for housekeeping, raising children, and nation building. At home, women would keep house and raise their children, freeing men to perform their work. Similarly, in the public realm, women would participate to lighten the burden, pressing heavily on the leaders. One of the major contributions of women's organization in pre-independence times was to raise and articulate women's demand for rights and right to vote, and to struggle continuously to get them. Bombay and Madras granted franchise to women in 1921, United Provinces in 1923, Punjab and Bengal in 1926, Assam, Bihar and Odisha in 1930. But this number was very small. WIA, AIWC and NCWI issued a joint memorandum in favor of universal adult franchise. Government of India Act 1935 extended franchise to 6 million women. Women's organization continued their struggle for women's rights. The passage of Child Marriage Restraint Act 1926, fixing age of marriage for girls at 14 and boys at 18, and Hindu Women's Right to Property Act 1937 gave them some satisfaction. The All India Women's Conference, AIWC, is the most influential women movement in India. The AIWC was founded in 1927, had large number of members. Initially, it was concerned to women's education issues, the movement to get equal education to the women, then was getting bigger issues, to give women opportunities to excel in education and other social issues. The achievement of these organizations can be seen when they elevate the women's issues, including education, social and legal reform. The most important of their movement become particular victories of women's movement was Child Marriage Reform Act 1929, struggle against parda, and campaign for women suffrage. Women's participation in the national movement. With the national movement gaining ground, women stepped on the streets. Models of women's participation put forward by the Gandhian Khilafat and extremist experience sought to establish a concept of nation as the extended family and therefore a legitimate sphere of women's activity. The Indian National Movement put forth the goal of a united modern Indian nation that would transcend differences of caste, religion, and language. With non-cooperation, the epoch of Gandhi began. He evolved a program of struggle which included all sections and most significantly women. In the active life of the country and the formation of women's organization at an all India level were two landmarks in the evolution of the women's movement. Women's organizations revealed the tension between confining women's issue to social reform efforts and the compulsion from the wider society to link national liberation to the women's movement. Participation of women in politics was a new step, yet ideologically, the act was appropriated as an extension of traditional rules. Three broad developments occurred around this time, opening up possibilities for women's participation in politics. One was Satyagraha movement of Gandhi, the other militant resurgent movement of the extremist trend, and the last the Khilafat movement. Gandhi was hailed as the parent of the Indian women's movement. Under Gandhi's influence, their participation in the freedom struggle became visible. The struggle was on an unprecedented massive scale. Gandhi turned traditional symbols and ideals into sources of inspiration and energy for women, who came out of their homes to organize meetings and processions, to sell khadi, to spread message of Swadeshi, to give away their jewelry, and to picket near the shops of liquor and foreign clothes. He respected the personal dignity without belittling their role as mothers and wives, and gave women with men equal tasks to perform in the achievements of freedom. He saw women not as objects of reform and humanitarianism, but as self-conscious arbiter of their own destiny. Women's entry into national politics through non-violent methods brought miraculous results. On one hand, women became aware of their inner strength, and on the other, process brought human and moral elements into politics. They had attended session the Indian National Congress and taken part in Swadeshi movement in Bengal in 1905 to 1911 and in the Home Rule movement. In non-cooperation movement, peasants women played an important role in the rural satyagrahas of Barsad and Bardoli. Thousands of women joined the satyagraha army of Gandhiji. They raised their voices against the Rowlatt Bill, forest laws, and went to jail. As a consequence of their defiance, women participated in the Salt Satyagraha and in the civil disobedience movement. They held meetings, organized processions, picketed shops, selling foreign clothes and liquor, and went to jail. Women participated in the freedom movement because they were inspired by patriotism and wanted to see the end of foreign rule. Women's participation in the freedom movement did not lead to a separate autonomous women's movement, since it was part of the anti-colonial movement. All India Women's Conference, AIWC. During Quit India movement in the 1940s, 20 years after the non-cooperation movement and 10 years past civil disobedience, more women came forward to participate, because when most of the men folk were in prison, women came forward to take charge of the struggle. Uneducated and educated women sacrificed time and materials, volunteering, campaigning, protesting, fasting, and donating to the cause of freedom. In Gandhian dialectics, the men and the women, grassroots workers, were the most important cogs in the whole machinery of the movement. They adopted various tools to mobilize the masses. The women's movement in pre-independent India has been often called the first wave feminism. In this phase, women blamed tradition and religion for their suffering and sought redress in education and legal change. They looked upon women as biologically, psychologically, and spiritually different from men and based their claim for representation in public life on the complementarity of their difference. Post-independence and current movements in India. In post-independent India, the contemporary feminist movement began by basing itself firmly on principles of equality and asserting that gender-based structures such as the sexual division of labor, oppressed and subordinated women, the differences between men and women was held largely to be a biological one, which should not affect women's right to equality with men in both public and private spheres. Among the movements such as the communist-led food campaigns of 1940, CIPCO of 1973, anti-alcohol and anti-price rise movement of 1970s, and those which were primarily dominated by men and in which large number of women were active, such as nationalist Tebanga and Telangana movements. Telangana movement. Telangana movement in 1948 was women movement in Hyderabad state that promoted by peasant women who struggled for their land, for better wages, abolition of VAT, and against exorbitant interest on grains and cash loans. It can be said that the Telangana movement, a revolutionary tradition among the Telugu people in terms of struggling for land right and leads to land reform. This movement involved in huge numbers of women to pressure the landlord and struggle against their cultural dominant. The immediate aftermath of partition and independence saw a steady increasing sense of betrayal on the part of workers and peasants, communists and socialists. The delay of Congress in the fulfillment of its promises of speedy and effective lands distribution influenced the Kisan Sabhas with a new spirit of opposition at a time when the impact of the Chinese Revolution was being felt by Indian communists, and there were sharecroppers, rallies, strikes, and demonstrations led by the Kisan Sabhas, criticizing government measures as insufficient and demanding laws reform. Most of these agitations were suppressed by the government through the arrest of peasant leaders, but this was not possible in the case of one of the earliest and most militant sharecroppers movement of 1948 to 50. Telangana movement in Andhra Pradesh, under the leadership of Maoist influence members of the CPI, that is Communist Party of India, some 2,500 villages in Telangana district were liberated, sharecroppers' debts were cancelled, rent payments were suspended, and land redistributed. In September 1948, Indian troops took over the state, arresting peasant leaders and firing upon demonstrators. The CPI was outlawed and the movement forced underground, where it took to guerrilla tactics. Though thousands of women had been active in these strikes and rallies, and the leader of the Telangana movement were unusual for their time in the attention they paid to such women problems as wife beating, making it known that they would chastise offenders, the attitude towards women remained one of benevolent paternalism. And when the movement went underground, women were not allowed to join the guerrillas, but were expected to perform the ancillary task of providing shelter, acting as messengers, etc. The exceptional women who did manage to push themselves into guerrilla movement later confessed how lonely they had felt. For while they were treated as having shed their womanliness, they were never accepted as being on par with women. CIPCO movement of 1973. In 1970, an organized resistance to the destruction of forests spread throughout India and came to be known as CIPCO movement. It began in hills, where the forests are main source of livelihood. The CIPCO movement got its name from the Hindi word CIPCO, which means to cling. This clinging to trees was a particular action people used to save trees which were crucial to their lives from being felled. The movement began in 1973 in the small hilly town of Gopeshwar in Chamoli district. It sparked off when representative from a sport factory came to cut trees. Women joined the movement under the leadership of an activist, Chandi Prasad Bhatt, went to forest and formed a circle around the trees, preventing the contractor from cutting trees. It was the women of CIPCO who brought to public attention the importance of trees and the need to protect the environment. The success achieved by this protest led to similar protests in other parts of the country. From their origins as a spontaneous protest against logging abuses in Uttar Pradesh, in the Himalayas, supporters of CIPCO movement, mainly women, have successfully banned the felling of trees in a large number of regions and influenced natural resource policy in India. Dhoom Singh Negi, Bachni Devi and many other village women were the first to save the trees by hugging them. They coined the slogan, "What do the forests bear? Soil, water and pure air." The success of CIPCO movement in the hills saved thousands of trees from being felled. Some other persons have also been involved in this movement and have also been involved in this movement, have given it proper direction. Sundarlal Bahuguna, a Gandhian activist and philosopher, whose appeal to Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the then Prime Minister of India, resulted in the green felling ban. Mr. Bahuguna coined the CIPCO slogan, "Ecology is permanent economy." He encouraged the development of local industries based on conservation and sustainable use of forest wealth for local benefits. The CIPCO protest in Uttar Pradesh achieved a major victory in 1980. With a 15-year ban on green felling in the Himalayan forest of that state by the order of the then Prime Minister. Nav Nirman movement of 1974. Initially a student movement in Gujarat for reduction in education fees, more campus facilities, distribution of quality food, and arrest of black marketers. Later on, it was against soaring prices, black marketing, and corruption. Their protests range from mass hunger strike, mock funeral, and Prabhat Feri. This was the first successful agitation after independence that ousted an elected government. It inspired Jayaprakash Narayan to launch the Total Revolution movement, fighting to reform as well as to limit state power, arguing that the Rajniti had become corrupt and decayed and the time for Lokniti had come. The outcome of the protest was the emergency. Chimmanbhai Patel became the Chief Minister of Gujarat in 1973. His reputation for corruption winning instant protest from students and teachers. Expectations of radical politics were running high at the time. Courtesy Indira Gandhi Garibi Hatao campaign, the urban middle class was unhappy because of the high price of essential commodities, while the countryside was demanding wages and food security. But what sparked off the agitation was student protest in Ahmedabad in December 1973 because of high mess bills and poor quality of food. There were clashes between the police and student and the students' committee, later known as Nav Nirman Yuvak Samiti, was formed to voice grievances. Question of reservation in politics. 1975 signaled another eventful period. The United Nations has declared the year as the International Women's Year, and the first World Conference on Women was held in Mexico in June 1975. Considering the grave conditions of women in all countries, the year was turned into a decade. Due to declaration of 1975 to 85 as the women decade, the government was forced to appoint commissions and committees to introduce certain relief measures for promoting gender equality. A number of differences arose in conceptualizing problems as well as in deciding strategies. The issues, methods, and thrust of action were considerably different in the women's movement. There is no exaggeration in saying that many of the measures introduced by the ruling government have been considerably due to the struggles launched by women. The enactment of amendments to the rape law or to the Dowry Act, the institution of structures such as family courts and the National Commission for Women, women police cells and gender sensitization programs. On the question of reservation, initially women's group were not in favor of reservation, but through experience they realized that the political parties would not on their own put up women as candidates. Therefore, they had no choice but to enter the debate of reservation and electoral politics. In 1993, women got 33% reservation in panchayats. The debate on the 18th constitutional amendment ensuring reservation of one-third seats for women in Lok Sabha and state assemblies had generated debates. Although parties give some place to women in their manifestos, the promises remain on paper. Most of them mobilize women for rallies and demonstration. Women do not find the place on decision-making committees of political parties. Even they have been making promises regarding 33% reservation for women candidates in parliament and state assemblies. But women candidates are not fielded in this proportion. The argument in favor of the bill are more or less the same as those presented before the Committee on the Status of Women. The difficulties faced by women in getting elected, the reluctance of political parties to give tickets to women, the possibility of women losing faith in the political process and become passive spectators, and the potential of the reservation system to motivate women and political parties. It is also argued that the bill would break the male bastion of power, provide the critical mass necessary to be effective in decision-making bodies, and broaden the base of women representation in the legislative bodies. The arguments against reservation also echo the arguments put forward by the Committee on Status of Women in its report. The committee felt that the women cause in India has always been championed by all progressive elements, men as well as women. Joint efforts are required for a climate favorable for raising women's status. The committee had made a noteworthy recommendation that political parties should adopt a definite policy regarding the percentage of women to be sponsored by them for election to state assemblies and parliament. The treatment that the bill for reservation of seats for women has received from male members of different parties recently has disappointed women's organizations and women legislators, but they are not disheartened. Some feel that reservation of seats for women is not the right strategy to erase gender inequality. Ila Bhatt of Seva feels that the reservation will not yield the desired result. What women need is economic power. Madhu Kishwar of Manusi has suggested an alternative bill. Women leaders such as Mrinal Gore, Pramila Dandavate have changed their earlier stand on reservation and now favor reservation of seats for women to legislature bodies. It is important to note in this context that there was not much resistance to the provision of reserved seats for women in the 73rd and 74th amendments. It's only after the bill for the 81st amendment that unprecedented chaotic scenes in the houses erupted over the bill. The issue of sub-quota for the backward classes and method of reserving constituency have been causing differences and apprehension. It is important that reservation will help women entering in decision-making bodies in sizable numbers. This critical mass is important if women's voices are to be heard in politics. But mere entry into the political system will not bring transparency, accountability, and commitment for the women's movement. Women have to recognize collectively and critically the forces that limit them, and to work collectively and continuously to change the unequal power structure. They have to be empowered. This is the process of gaining control over the self, the ideology, and the resources, physical, human, intellectual, and financial, which determine power. So, students, let's summarize what we have learned in this module. Women's movement in India can be seen before and after independence. These movements have achievements in different fields, including पॉलिटिकल अरेना, सोशल वेलफेयर एंड लीगल इश्यूज सच एज चाइल्ड मैरिज रिफॉर्म एक्ट 1929, कैंपेन अगेंस्ट पर्दा एंड वेमेन्स सफरेज, द लिमिटेशन ऑफ वेमेन्स मूवमेंट्स आर कॉज बाय पेट्रियार्कल सिस्टम दैट टाइड पीपल्स माइंडसेट इन इंडिया. द कास्ट सिस्टम हैज ऑल्सो लिमिटेड वेमेन इन गेटिंग अपॉर्चुनिटीज especially in colonial era. Right now, women's movements are struggling for justice and equality. History shows that the struggle for women's rights is long and protracted. It is a struggle that must be waged and won. The women's movement thus has a long way to go in its struggle for bringing about new values, a new morality, and a new egalitarian relationship. Thank you.